Teaching and Learning, an Overview of the Contemporary Context, prepared by Vicky Squires and Christine Drever-Charles. Post-secondary education is encountering significant pressure to change its approach to teaching and learning based on a number of factors. One, there's increased competition for faculty and students. This also is connected to globalization. And in many countries, there's massification, or significantly more students attending and being asked to attend university and college. As well, there's increasing student mobility and, increasingly, a diverse student population, including mature students. There's inequitable access that some universities and colleges are trying to address. As well, there are economic pressures. Different countries, different time frames. It can happen overnight. It can happen over an extended period, like the recession in 2008. There's also a shift in view of universities from being a public good to a private good. So then, who needs to pay for the education? There's an increasing emphasis on quality assurance and accountability and metrics to measure how you're achieving your goals. And lastly, information and communications technology is playing a big influence in both the teaching and learning side of the mission. These pressures and the increased focus on scholarship and research in teaching and learning are leading to gradual shifts in the environment. Although teaching and learning are two sides of the same coin, the best instructors, according to Bain, are those who consider how learning can best be facilitated in the classroom. Traditional lecture-style delivery and assessment practices do not achieve the best learning outcomes, and significant research supports this need to adapt classrooms and teaching styles. There are several factors to explore. The first factor is understanding the nature of student learning and student development. While there are many existing and emergent theories that explain this phenomenon, the best instructors have also developed an implicit knowledge of how learning works. There are many theories of learning and the interplay of intrapersonal and external factors that affect learning. For example, Ambrose, Bridges, DiPietro, Lovett, and Norman posited that learning is a process, not a product. Furthermore, learning involves change in knowledge, beliefs, behaviors, or attitudes. Lastly, learning is active rather than passive. It is something that students have to do for themselves. According to Ryan and Desi, motivation plays a role in whether students choose to engage deeply in their learning. Varying degrees of intrinsic and extrinsic motivation affect the effort that students invest in particular tasks and activities. Motivation is one piece of their broader theory of self-determination that explains how individuals approach their own growth and learning. Tinto also focused on goals and motivation to explain students' persistence in their learning journey. Implicit in these theories is that all students are unique. They bring particular previous knowledge experiences and learning styles to the classroom. Additionally, they bring their own challenges to the class. As Bain contended, instructors build trust and develop respectful relationships with the students in the class so that they feel welcome and supported. Developing this climate is particularly important for facilitating student persistence and mitigating the factors that Koo contended had a negative impact on student persistence. There are a number of factors that can affect student success, and they're identified by lots of different researchers. But Koo, for example, said that being academically underprepared for college-level work is one thing that can get in the way of success. As well, if there is a gap between high school and college, first-generation college students are also more at risk. Working more than 30 hours a week is also a risk factor. Part-time enrollment is also another risk factor. Single parenting or having children at home also affect the ability of students to devote time to their studies. Financial independence, while it might sound good, just really means that you have no one to depend on to help you out with the financial support. So in some cases, that means having no partner or no family to help when you need extra finances. On the other hand, as Koo pointed out, there are some factors that can promote student persistence. One is psychosocial fit. So the student feeling affinity and a sense of belonging for their college, for their program. Another is academic and social support. So having some academic support, such as advisors or writing support, but also social support, so opportunities to join clubs. Involvement in beneficial programs that result in mental, physical, and or social growth are also a mitigating factor in promoting student success. Having a positive academic trajectory also helps. So seeing success helps you be more successful. Finally, engaging in goal realization and identifying personally meaningful and relevant goals that you can work towards helps people persist. Institutions and instructors, armed with this knowledge, though, can build support such as learning communities, informal and formal events to promote belonging, and academic and career advising supports. Moreover, broader strategies that support our diverse student body, such as efforts towards indigenization and internationalization, attempt to foster understanding and promote a sense of belonging for all of our students. Tintu argued that institutions can only go so far in student success. Classes and instruction need to be key components of student success. Tintu identified that well-articulated expectations, meaningful and targeted assessment and feedback, engaging in relevant activities within the class, and academic supports can all facilitate student success. Tinto's findings reflect the results from Bain's study. According to Bain, the best instructors understand how learning works. They invest significant time into designing a respectful and trusting environment and preparing activities that support deep learning. Expectations are clearly outlined, relevant, challenging, yet achievable. They engage students in a natural, critical learning environment where students have an opportunity to work individually and collaboratively in tasks that promote an examination of their own mental models. Also, according to Bain, assessment is based on the identified learning outcomes, and genuine, constructive feedback is given to the students. Furthermore, students are encouraged to reflect on their experiences and the feedback in order to gain a deeper understanding of the constructs and their own learning. Shifting teaching practice on campuses to reflect what we know about effective teaching and learning environments will require support from senior leadership. As Summerlee and Christensen argued, structures that reward teaching should parallel recognition for research excellence. Furthermore, centers that engage in the scholarship of teaching and learning and that work with faculty to explore new methods of teaching are key supports in changing the environment. Resources need to be devoted to infrastructure as well, such as replacing the structure of large class sizes taught by junior faculty with smaller classes taught by the most experienced instructors with other learning supports in place. Classroom spaces need to be redesigned to allow for discussion and group work. Enhanced use of e-learning technologies in online classes also requires enhanced technological infrastructure. So given all of this, what will the classrooms of the future look like? That's an intriguing question.